So hi guys, my name is Mansi Anand and I welcome you to this series called RBI 24/7. So guys, as you know that in this series we discuss some concepts which are related to finance and economics current affairs. So since we are starting with the new week, so we are I'm going to start with a special session. So we are not going to discuss questions here, but about a trend which is prevalent, right? So I hope you like this session and it is beneficial for you, right? And this topic is, the topic is Bangladesh going to surpass India's GDP? So guys, recently there has been a forecast by IMF that Bangladesh's per capita GDP or per capita income is going to surpass that of India, right? So here we are going to discuss some facts, some statistics that, okay, where are we leading? Is this really going to happen? Or what do the facts say, right? And before starting with this session, I would like to ask you guys to subscribe to our channel. So if you are watching our video for the very first time and you are new here, then do not forget to subscribe to our channel. It can help you to stay in touch with us, and pressing this bell icon is going to help you to get notified whenever a new video comes up. After that, you can also join our Telegram group. On this group, you can post all your doubts and queries and we'll try to resolve them as soon as possible. Apart from that, if you have any doubt or if there is any topic that you want me to take up, then you can also mention it as a comment on the video and we'll try to take it up as soon as possible. So guys, since we get a lot of requests, so there can be some delay, or because in every session I can only resort to two or three doubts. Some I try to answer it in the comments itself, but so do not get disheartened if your doubt is not coming up. Either mention it again on the, and try to do it on the latest video, and we are definitely going to resort it, right? Okay, now starting with this session. Okay, so Bangladesh might beat India's per capita GDP as per an IMF report. So according to this IMF report, World Economic Outlook, Bangladesh's per capita GDP in dollar terms is expected to grow 4% in 2020. Here we are discussing that what is in that report, right? So IMF is expecting that Bangladesh's per capita GDP can go to $1,888, right? So guys, what is this per capita GDP? Per capita GDP is an average that is found out, and it indicates the average income of one person in a nation, right? So the higher the per capita GDP, we consider that a person belonging to that country is richer. So let's say, to just clear this concept, what do we do? We take the national income or total output of a country and then we divide it by the population of a country. Very simple, simple maths. And then you find out that what is the income of per person in the country. So it's just an average. Like if considering, let's say in US, if per capita GDP annually of every person is $1,00,000, whereas in India it is, let's say, $10,000, it means every American person is richer than every Indian person 10 times, right? So this is just an average that tells you about the income, the welfare of the people, or the living standard of most of the people in a country, right? I hope now you are clear with the per capita GDP thing. Okay, now IMF is expecting that Bangladesh's per capita GDP can be this, whereas India's per capita GDP is expected to decline to 1,877. So you can see there is a difference. So this is just an estimate for now, but this is a big thing because India being a huge country and compared to a smaller country, smaller neighboring country like Bangladesh, is a big thing. That tells us that how badly India has been hit by the COVID-19 pandemic, and income of every person, or at least majority population of India, has been hit by the impacts of COVID-19, right? So this income is going to be the lowest in last 4 years. So you can see there is a decline of 10.5%, whereas in case of Bangladesh, there is a growth of 4% in 2020. So GDP figure for both countries is at current prices. This makes India the third poorest country in South Asia after Pakistan and Nepal. So if we rank all the countries of South Asia, India is going to be the last third one, right? Whereas Bangladesh, Bhutan, Sri Lanka and Maldives would be ahead of India, not in terms of total GDP but in terms of per capita GDP, right? So IMF has forecasted this in one of the recent reports. Okay, moving ahead, here you can see in the graph the forecast. Okay, the yellow line tells you about Bangladesh's income, blue one about India, and the gray one about Nepal. So you can see how here Bangladesh is going to surpass India by a little margin, right? Moving ahead. Okay, before we move ahead to the reasons that why Bangladesh is doing so good or why India is not doing that much good, let us learn about some concepts that are going to help us in the session later. So first of all, talking about the Asian tigers. So what are Asian tigers? Asian tigers refers to four economies. So it's a term given to four economies which have grown really fast. And which are these four economies? South Korea, Taiwan, Hong Kong and Singapore. Hong Kong and Singapore, as you must be knowing, these are two of the major financial centers of the world, right? Whenever we talk about developing an IFSC in India, in Gujarat, Gift City, so we have discussed all these terms in our previous sessions. I hope you are aware of it. If not, you can ask for the link. And briefly, to give you brief, an IFSC is a special jurisdiction which provides international clients with some special financial services, right? So we talk about developing Gift City in Gujarat as a major financial center of the world, just as Hong Kong and Singapore. Whereas South Korea and Taiwan, they are into tech. We hear about Korean products and products made in Taiwan, right? So these are four major economies in Asia which have maintained growth at a good pace since 1960s, right? Fueled by exports and rapid industrialization. So they are known as four Asian tigers. So apart from these four Asian tigers, there are other economies which are known as Asian cubs. Probably smaller than them but still developing at fast pace. So guys, here is a question for you. You have to go and search that which are the economies which are known as these Asian cubs, and you have to mention it in the comments, right? So let's see who gives the correct answer. And after that, collectively join the ranks of world's wealthiest nations. So these are four Asian tigers, right? After that, moving ahead to, okay, China plus one model. So I think we have discussed it so many times in our previous sessions that how China is one of the major economies of the world. I think China and US, what they do has an impact on the entire world. When they were indulged into a US-China trade war, I think trade was down for almost the entire world, right? So these are such major economies, right? So China has been among the world's fastest growing economies, with real annual gross domestic product averaging 9.5% through 2018. China has become world's largest economy on a purchasing power parity basis. So what is this PPPA basis? I hope you remember, we had a special session in which we discussed this PPP concept in great detail, right? So guys, this is little bit tricky to understand the PPP concept. So it is my recommendation that if you do not know about it, then you should watch that session, and I think it is going to help you, right? So if we consider on a PPP basis, China has become world's largest economy. We also discussed what was India's rank based on PPP, right? So you can check that session out. So we all know about China being the factory of the world, being the manufacturing giant, especially in Asia and also in the entire world, right? So what is one major thing which has boosted China's economy? Exports. Also, we come to know about many times that how China likes to keep its currency depreciated so that its exports, they remain competitive or they are cheaper to the entire world, right? So the main reason or the major factor behind China's growth is its exports, it being a manufacturer, merchandise trader, holder of foreign exchange reserves, right? So one of the most powerful economy of the world, right? So now coming, and many Asian countries, these Asian tigers also, they have tried to replicate the model of China so that they can focus on developing their exports and booming their economies with the help of that, right? Now coming to China plus one model, I think we have also discussed it, but China plus one model, if I briefly talk about it, it means that the companies which are settled in China, right? We know that China had the competitive advantage of cheap labor. That is why major companies of the world, they liked to set their factories in China and do the production in China because it was cheaper to produce there. One major factor was cheap labor, right? Now, since after the US-China trade war and after the growing negative sentiment regarding China after the spread of COVID-19 pandemic, many companies were planning to shift from China and shift their factories to nearby Asian economies which have some same benefits as China, majorly of cheap labor, right? So this strategy of shifting their factories from China to the neighboring countries which provide same benefits is known as plus one strategy, right? To avoid investing only in China. So they keep some of their factories, some of their production in China, but also invest in nearby countries, diversify into other countries. Now, which Asian countries they can have the benefit of this China plus one model? Countries like, first of all, India. Government has been on a spree to develop India, the Atmanirbhar package, trying to make India self-reliant, boosting the domestic production so that we can invite foreign companies to set up their production units or manufacturing units here. Apart from India, there is Bangladesh, there is Vietnam, there is Indonesia, right? Now, although our government is very keen on developing our production or manufacturing capabilities, but is it actually getting success in that? Because many smaller countries which surround India, if you compare India to these smaller countries, obviously we are a big nation, but are we actually able to snatch this opportunity or this room which is vacated by China from all these countries? Not that easily, right? That is why these smaller countries are also in the race, and they are doing on some grounds they are doing much better than India. That is why Bangladesh has been given such announcement or such ranking by IMF, right? So I hope you all are clear with this concept, China's export model, after that China plus one model. We are going to need these concepts further in the session. Okay, now coming to Bangladesh, here in this session we are going to focus on Bangladesh. Regarding other countries we can discuss it, and right, so here we are going to discuss about Bangladesh. What made Bangladesh a development miracle? So Bangladesh has been a country which has been known to be very poor, right? We do not consider it as a major power, but in past few years it has shown tremendous growth, and it has come to be known as development. This has come to be known as development miracle of Bangladesh. So what are such factors? Moving ahead. Okay, the first point here is textile-led growth. I think this is the most important factor here, that Bangladesh is keen on developing their textile industry, right? And This textile industry has been providing employment to a major chunk of the country, developing them and improving their standard of living, providing welfare to the public, right? So textile led growth. So textile India also has abundance of cheap labor which can work in this textile type business, because textile, as you must know, that textile is a labor intensive business. And a country which has a lot of people, or which has got a huge population, and that population is not very skilled enough to work on some high tech, to work into some high tech industries like IT, textile is a very good option to provide employment to such low skilled workers, right? And Bangladesh has been keen on developing this. So push to low skill manufacturing, right? So we might think that, okay, they are developing products which do not require much skills. But see, the point is you have to think of developing industries according to the capabilities of people of your country, right? If people are low skilled, it's better to develop such industries where labor requirement is more than capital requirement. So they are doing it very nicely, very beautifully by developing textile industry. So they are following the path of Asian tigers by focusing on their exports, by focusing on the industry called RMG, which means ready-made garments, right? So low-skilled goods export, which is in line with its share of poor country working age population. As I just told you, you have to develop industries in alignment with the skills of your population, right? So if it's a poor country and people and not many people are educated, you cannot think of developing very high-fi industries or getting people to learn coding or getting into AI or machine learning. So we have to provide them employment which is in alignment to their skills. So RMG, the ready-made garment industry, the backbone of Bangladeshi economy, export driven. This RMG sector accounts for more than 80% of its exports. So you can see how greatly Bangladesh is dependent upon this industry and contributes about 20% to its national output. Low cost of production and loose labor regulations have been one major factor. So in a country where labor regulation, I think loose labor regulations, this is one factor which drives foreign companies to Asian countries, right? Because in Western economies, the labor regulations are very tight and they cannot, it's not easy to avail the benefit of cheap labor, which is possible in Asian countries, right? So these are some factors driving their industry. Harboring economies of scale owing to market dominance by large firms. Okay, here I would like to draw some comparison to India, right? Like Bangladesh, we are also a labor abundant nation, but the problem in India is we are an export driven nation. We do export stuff, but India has not been able to develop low skill manufacturing. The products that India exports, like softwares, it requires high skills, and not everyone is educated enough to get involved into that industry, and that can provide employment to a smaller chunk of educated people, not the abundance of nation, or not the abundant, not the major chunk of the nation, right? So this is one point where India has to compare, or India has to focus. After that, we have learned in one of our previous sessions that how in India there is one major problem, that our firms are not able to develop into large scale firms. See, a large scale firm is obviously able to cut its cost because of economies of scale. When you produce on a larger scale, the per unit cost comes down, right? So this is one major problem in India, that our firms, they remain in the middle segment, right? They are not able to jump to the higher segment. Small firms are not able to become mid firms are not able to become larger firms. So this is one major area where India has to focus, that how can we let our firms grow so that they can produce at a cheaper rate. This is one major factor for China's growth also, that they produce on such large scale that their per unit cost falls down, right? Whereas in Bangladesh, this RMG industry is dominated by large firms which avail the benefit of economies of scale, right? After that, duty free access to European market, a major import hub. They can export products to European market. They have access there and they do not have to pay much taxes, right? So first point is textile led growth. Here you can see the graph, nationwide employment. See the proportion of employment into textile industry, how it has grown from 1980s. It was not even 1 million, and now it provides employment to about 3 million people in the country according to the data of 2010, right? Okay, this is one graph which is very interesting, right? Okay, if these nations are not very clear to you, don't worry, I'm going to read it out for you. Okay, so this one is Bangladesh. Here the red dot signifies India. Here is Vietnam. And here is China. Okay, so I hope now the graph is clear. See guys, on the x-axis this graph tells you about share of working age population among non-high income countries. That means how much of the population is into, see you can see labor endowment and low skill export performance in developing countries according to 2018. So this tells you that India's this much population is working age population. That means this x-axis tells you about the share of population that the country is having in non-high income countries. Okay, this might seem a little tricky. To make it simple, try understanding that if we take a collection of countries which are not high income, which are relatively considered to be non-high income countries, what share of working age population does a country have? As you know, India is a super populous country. So India is having a high share of population, a high share of working age population among the non-high income countries. So this tells you about the share of population a country has. After that, share of low skill manufacturing exports among non-high income nation. And this y-axis tells you that what is country's share in low skill manufacturing exports, right? So you can see India is having a lot of population which needs to get into low skill manufacturing, but its share in low skill manufacturing is very low, right? So there is not balance. We have a lot of people who need to get into this industry, the low skill manufacturing industry, export industry, but they are not able to do so because we have lesser share of low skill exports but higher share of low skilled population among the non-high income countries. Whereas if you see Bangladesh, the proportion is, it is almost in proportion, the amount of population it has is almost equal to the share of exports it has among the non-high income countries. That means it is almost able to generate that much employment that the country needs, right? In case of Vietnam is above it. That means it has higher employment than it needs, right? So higher employment into low skill industry than it requires. So, and China, you can see larger share of both the parameters, right? So it has larger population which is involved, and it is also having a huge share of low skill manufactured products which are exported, right? So this is a very interesting graph. I hope it's clear to you. So this shows you about India. This shows you that India's position is not very good as compared to other nations, right? Okay, moving ahead. So first point was textile led growth, and now we come to the other point, which is remittances. Remittances means the money which a person living outside his or her home country sends back to his or her home country. So if you have a relative in USA working there and that person sends money back to their home, to their parents in India, that is counted as remittance, right? So Bangladesh is a country which receives huge remittances from its population working outside Bangladesh, especially from West Asia, right? So boom in the garment sector led to huge migration from rural to urban areas, which boosted remittances coming into the rural economy. See, remittances not necessarily are cross-border, they can be into one country. Let's say if someone belongs to a small village in Odisha and comes to work here in Delhi and sends money back to their village, that is also considered a remittance for that village. Basically, money coming from outside, right? So since there was urbanization, people shifted because there was employment in urban areas. Because of this ready-made garment sector, people shifted, led to urbanization. And obviously, if they shifted to urban areas, they sent money back to their hometowns, right? Which increased remittances into the rural economy. After that, they also receive cross-border remittances from people working outside Bangladesh. Made foreign exchange. So this point made foreign exchange available for accelerated economic growth, overcoming the foreign exchange investment gap. So this provides them with foreign exchange. After that, HSBC predicted that Bangladesh would be 26th largest economy in the world by 2030. But this prediction was in the pre-COVID period. So we do not know what is going to happen after COVID, but this is one prediction. So you can see the pace of growth by Bangladesh into the pre-COVID period, right? So second point is remittances. Moving ahead, agriculture. Now they are also working on agriculture. Obviously, as I told you, being a low-skilled economy, they need to develop such sectors which does not require much of educational qualifications. So agriculture contributes just 14% to Bangladesh economic output, but employs over 40% of the workforce. So how agriculture was benefited because of this ready-made garment industry that we are going to discuss here. Now see, I just told you that people moved from rural areas to urban areas to work into ready-made garment industry, right? Now obviously, if people move from rural to urban areas, that results in lack of labor or shortage of labor into rural areas. And if there is shortage of labor or lack of labor, that means wages here in rural areas are going to rise. So this created a pressure, upward pressure on wages in the rural area, benefiting the rural economy as well, right? Creating pressure on wages in the crop sector, which is dominated by paddy, country's staple diet, right? After that, eventually led to a shift from crop sector to high value non-crop sector such as poultry, vegetable, livestock and fisheries. See, we just learned that rural areas were getting remittances from the urban areas, people working in urban areas, and also many people moved to urban areas, which led to a shortage of labor, right? So higher wages and money coming from urban areas, this led to people shift from agriculture to some non-crop sectors related to agriculture like poultry, vegetable, livestock, fisheries, right? So this shifted people from agriculture, and when people shift from a sector, obviously there is a lack of labor, then wages are going to get higher, right? In 2019, Bangladesh was the fourth largest producer, second largest jute producer, fourth largest rice producer, fourth largest mango producer, fifth largest vegetable producer, and fourth largest inland fish producer in the world. So you can see the growth in their agriculture also, like a robust growth in agriculture. Moving ahead. Okay, moving ahead, ready-made garment, which has been a driving factor for Bangladesh, has also helped them to fulfill the gender gap, right? Because it has resulted into creation of good formal sector jobs for women also, right? So development of this sector provided employment opportunities to women. Now see, only this employment opportunity is not enough. When women, they get financially independent, obviously they are not, they their education levels rises and they are less prone to exploitation, right? So when women started earning, they started getting good jobs. This led to declining rates of fertility. That means lesser children, lesser growth of population, increasing age of marriages, so no child marriages, and rapid increase in girls' educational attainment, right? So this financial independence given to women, it results into reduction in social evils of the society, or it makes women less prone, less vulnerable to exploitation, right? So transition from informal jobs in very poor conditions to better job with a focus on exports, getting good primary education, especially for girls. So this is one thing for government also. They also work on developing the human capital by providing better educational facilities, better health facilities to their public. So good primary education, especially for girls, has been an additional benefit of starting to manage better and bring down Bangladesh's large and densely packed population. Obviously, we just learned that marriages are taking place at a higher age or in the later stages of life, that which automatically means lesser children and falling rates of fertility, right? And obviously, educated people are prone to have lesser children, right? And invest more on their education. So that creates a development cycle just by making women financially independent. So you can see one thing can have so much impact. So there is only a financial input by providing jobs to women, by providing livelihood to them, but it results in so many areas, or it has a positive impact in so many areas. So if we talk about this picture, this is a movie which is called Made in Bangladesh. If you are interested, you can go and watch it. After that, Bangladesh has 2 out of 5 women of working age in the labor force. That comes out about 40%. Two out of every five women. Double from India's rate, that is 21%. We have the female participation rate of 21%. So you can see there is so much untapped human capital that we can use, or we can capitalize on if we put emphasis on girls' education and their employment, right? Moving ahead. Okay, here you can see Bangladesh's robust growth in GDP per capita. So these bars, they tells you about per capita income from financial year 91 to financial year 17. So guys, you can see a drastic upward movement in the per capita GDP. That means per capita GDP, as I just told you, which tells you about earning of one person, right? After that, GDP growth, annual percent, you can see by this line, right? Okay, now what lies ahead, the future? This is a Bloomberg chart which tells you about, which is a prediction of year 2025, where you can see Bangladesh and India, they are almost equal, right? So this comes from IMF, World Economic Outlook. So you can see you can witness here that by investing on human capital, by providing employment to their women, a small country like Bangladesh is competing with a huge country like India, right? So, and there are many things from these factors that India can learn, that we can take in, that can benefit us as well, right? Moving ahead. Okay, talking about India, see, whatever we discussed here, we have already discussed many points that India is lacking, but let's just put them in a comprehensive form. First of all, India's missing low skill jobs. We need to develop low skill jobs because our major population needs it. Not everyone is educated enough to get into sectors like IT, right? So sectors like textile and clothing or shoes, which does not require much of educational qualification, can lead to huge employment generation. After that, India has 8 times the population to Bangladesh, but it has 20 times the fatalities by COVID. Right? So you can see the difference. COVID, that is why COVID has had such a huge impact on Indian economy. So we need to control the virus as fast as possible if we want recovery to be fast, economic recovery. So COVID-19 wiped out almost 10.3% of Indian output, which is nearly 2.5 times the loss the global economy is expected to suffer. So we are at a huge vulnerable position because we are suffering a lot as compared to other peers. Some factors which can delay India's recovery. First of all, fiscal squeamishness. That means our fiscal constraints. Governments is not able to spend that much. See, as you have been reading in newspapers, that we have had 2 stimulus packages till now, but still economists are saying that this is not enough. We need more. Being such a huge country comprising of so many people, we need more so that we can make those benefits reach to the lower level, right? So I was reading somewhere that recently the LTC cash voucher scheme, which has been provided by government, in which they are giving LTC benefits on shopping to government employees. In this scheme also, this sounds like a very good scheme, but in this scheme also, they have to spend it on goods which are applicable for 12% or more GST. And I think textiles are not a part of that good. So if anyone spends on textiles, they are not eligible for this exemption. So this can be a drawback for textile industry if we want to develop it in our country. So fiscal constraints, undercapitalized financial systems, although government is working on it, we have learned about recapitalization bond, but we have to see, we have to wait so that our banks, they get recapitalized faster and they can move their lending activity. After that, multi-year investment fund, that means if the investment plans which are divided into many years, we need capital expenditure right now so that employment can be generated. Tendency to salvation, tendency to believe in salvation in autarky. So autarky in simple sense means import substitution. As you know, our governments, they are on a spree to put import barriers so that domestic industry in India can be developed. But see, is it possible to develop industry at a very fast rate? So many economists are of the view that trade is good, importing is not bad, as long as you maintain your exports and you are importing that stuff that you are not able to produce at lower cost in your own country, right? So our policymakers, they tend to find salvation or they tend to find satisfaction in import substitution, that we have put barriers to imports and now we'll grow at a fast rate. But this is not enough, putting just import barriers. We have to analyze which are the areas where import barriers should be put and they would be efficient there, right? So it should be given a thought. After that, India has not been able to tap participation, women participation in workforce. After that, inability to access room ceded by China at the lower end of spectrum. So as we were talking about the China plus one models, many big companies are looking to exit China or diversify their investments. So that means there is opportunity to produce some goods that China used to do. So if we develop our capabilities at such low skill jobs where we can provide cheap labor costs to these companies, we might be able to attract some of these companies, right? So we'll have to wait and watch that what is going to be the results of government, because many state governments have been trying to attract foreign companies, but future is going to tell us that what is the result of these steps taken, right? So these are some of the things that we can learn from Bangladesh and their development miracle. Okay, so guys, this was our special session on Bangladesh, and I hope you learned something new from this video. And before ending the session, I would like to take some doubts. Just give me a second. Okay, there was a question by Sadaf that she was asking that which is, what is more dangerous for the country, inflation or recession? And this was probably asked in an RBI interview. So see, this is not a question where you can choose out of both, because depending on the conditions of the country, both can be equally dangerous. And if you see, currently we are witnessing the situation of both, right? So earlier it was considered that these two concepts, inflation and recession, they are mutually exclusive and one cannot happen with another, but we are witnessing both at the same time, India right now. So that is why we need to find causes behind both, and we need to find some unconventional tools that can impact both of them. So if you are answering this question in an interview, you cannot choose one out of the two, but what you can do is to try and describe the current situation of the economy and then tell that what is going to be the impact of both of the situations, right? And probably what are the measures that can be used against it. Okay, after this, okay, just give me a second. Okay. So there was a question by Prachu that if there is a deficit in BOP, if there is a deficit in the current account of BOP, then why does it lead to a surplus in capital accounts? See, we need our BOP to be balanced. If your current account is in deficit, so your current account is in deficit, that means your imports, they exceed the exports. That means you are purchasing more from foreign countries and you are selling less. That creates a deficit. Now obviously you will have to pay for these imports, and the balance, the deficit, you will have to pay for it. If you pay for it, you will have to borrow money from outside the country, and if you borrow money, the money comes to you under capital account. So you get money under capital account, which pushes up the capital account, right? So this is the mechanism to balance both of them. And if we take the opposite situation, if current account is in surplus, that means exports are exceeding imports, that means you have surplus of money. You need to put it somewhere or invest it somewhere. So then probably you are going to invest it out of your country, right? Or you are going to witness some outflow of money from your country, which is going to create a deficit in the capital account. So simply you have to balance both of the accounts, right? Okay, so guys, these were some doubts. I hope now your doubts are clear, and you can always mention your doubts on the videos, and I'll see you in the next session. Till then, you take care of your health, take care of your studies, and thank you for being here.